And we are live.
Welcome to the Nature Journal Club workshop part two on how to dry out wildflowers. So if you weren't here for the previous one, last month we looked at how to foreshorten sort of flowers with a very kind of simple flat shape like a daisy, and looked at some of the aspects of foreshortening which we see with flowers like that. But today what I want to do is to kind of dive deep into a few of the drawing tricks that emerge when you start drawing complicated flower shapes, such as an iris with all sorts of twisting and curling petals, or things with really a complex structure with a lot of repeating shapes. And what I think you'll find is that the drawing concepts and ideas which we explore here, you're going to see again and again and again and again in all sorts of different drawing and sketching situations. And so these are tricks that are not specific to drawing wildflowers, but can really kind of be applied broadly across any subject that you choose to sketch. So what we're going to do is start with a close look at flowers with curling leaves and sort of folded petals. And I hope to kind of demystify and make this something that's open to everybody to be able to sketch. This was a little iris that was out in front of my house, and I went out early in the morning on May 12th of last year, and it was still growing, and I figured it's just about ready to burst open. And then on the 15th at 6 in the morning, I got out there just when the first petal had opened up, and by 8:30, all the sepals had bump, 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 bump. It had opened up, and by that evening at 7 p.m. it was fully big flower, looking really good. So actually, I'm going to see if I can on the screen. You know, just a little bit more. There we go. So I just fell in love with this flower, and I just started following it through time. And I think a lot of flowers, as they start to senesce and the petals begin to kind of curl up and wilt, it actually takes on an even more wonderful beauty than the ones that are just kind of the perfect hallmark fresh flower. And these are just terrific subjects to sketch, and I want to make you not afraid of trying to draw these today. This was kind of fun. As this thing started to wilt, then I started to see this other little purple spike starting to come up. And as it was this kind of wonderful moment with this sort of the youth of this potential energy of this one flower coming up, as this other one was just absolutely curled up on itself. I ended up following this flower for months as it went and wilted and turned to seed pods. Here we are at the end of June, and by or July, and by the end of August, it had turned brown, and I wanted to see how is the seed pod going to open? And then it got weed whacked. But it was so much fun following this, and want to open up those possibilities for everybody here. I will often make a diagram, a sketch of the different structures of a plant. If you halfway through a painting, you realize, oh, this thing actually inserts here on this, and that's above it. I wish I knew that before. You'll wish that you knew that before. So very often it helps just to stop, slow down, and kind of look at the structure as a botanist might, as you're kind of getting into that flower. Something that's neat about these irises is that big kind of petal-looking thing that droops down. There are three of them. Those are actually the sepals. They have petaloid sepals that flop down around them, and this structure that curls up above that is actually its pistil. And the petals are these strange things, that these three skinny things that stick up in the middle. So you get in there, and the structure of this thing is just, it's just bizarre. It's wonderful. Helps you to figure out some of those structures before you start drawing. But should you decide to take on the challenge, you're going to have to deal with curling petals and leaves and things. A lot of people are afraid of drawing any kind of curling petal, so, or a leaf, and if there's a leaf that's coming out of a plant towards you and it's curled over and you see part of the top and part of the bottom, a lot of people will take this complex shape, and what they'll do is they'll say, all right, I'm going to just sort of draw that like this, sticking out to the side. So you've ironed it flat and then turned it so that you're looking face down on it out from the side of your plant. And there's nothing, that's a fast way of recording information about something, but wouldn't it be nice if you could actually draw these things at all the goofy twisting angles that they're popping out towards you, and you can. So there's a handful of tricks that are going to be really, really useful in taking those at first sort of scary twisting shapes and allowing you to visualize them in such a way that you can get them down onto the paper. So to help you do this, we're going to look at two ways of seeing a structure, seeing an object. And what you're going to want to do is train your brain to kind of flip back and forth between these two completely different ways of visualizing something. And as an artist, I will jump back and forth between these two. Right? And to help us with this is this little piece of curling ribbon. As this ribbon, if you fold it, you're going to get sort of sharp corners. Here, it's just sort of twisting, kind of flopping back and forth. What I want to do is to first not think of this as a ribbon, but to think of this as just a bunch of interlocking shapes. I want to train my eye to look at this, and instead of sort of saying, I've got this ribbon that is with two sides and it's sort of curling around, that I have a shape that's this little odd D-shaped thing here. It's next to this one here that kind of pinches out, gets wider, and then has a squared off base. So what I'm going to be trying to do is to get my brain to give up the three-dimensional shape that's in front of me and just boil that down to a bunch of flat shapes that where one is next to another is next to another. If I can see these as a flat two-dimensional shape, I can transfer that over to my paper. But sometimes it's hard to visualize this thing this way when you're looking at this. But just take a moment to look at this. Can you get your brain to kind of see that as a shape? And here's my next shape. Here's my next shape. And so when I'm drawing this, I'm thinking, okay, right corner here, another right corner comes out shorter. Up, what is that angle there? How does that angle? I'm just looking at that, not as a piece of the ribbon, but actually as a shape. So this is one way of visualizing things. And you'll see in a moment how this is going to really come into play in a wonderful way as you try to draw leaves and petals. The second way of thinking about this is structural. I'm not going to think of it as a bunch of interlocking shapes. Instead, I'm going to think of this as this two-sided surface that's curling around, and this two-sided surface there are two sides on it, the top and the bottom sides. So it's a surface with a side on, with two sides on either side, and that's twisting around. And sometimes I'm looking at the underside of it, sometimes I'm looking at the top side of it. Each side of this, here's the top side of it. Right. I can trace that line around. Here's the top side of it. So can you see how that relates to that? All I've done is I've extracted one of the lines that makes up one of the sides of these. If this is perfectly vertical, and I'm looking at it from an angle, I will see the top and the bottom edges basically staying parallel with each other all the way through this sort of twisting and turning. But if it's wobbling and wobbling around, and sometimes this is flipped towards me, these lines don't have to be the top and the bottom sides. If it's someplace that's at an angle, these do not have to be exactly the same shape. So here's my top edge, here's my bottom edge, and as I look at this drawing here, there are, or I should say the top side and the bottom side, there are edges of this shape here that are not made by the top and the bottom side. They are made by a place where the surface of the ribbon is curling around, and as it comes around a corner, I'm seeing part of that surface on that corner. So I have the edge, these edges are made either by the top or the bottom sides, or the surface curling around. So to give you another example of how you might see that surface, if I just take a piece of paper that has a side and a side, and I hold it like this, you're now seeing an edge that is formed by the surface. That's what I'm seeing, say, around here. This edge here is formed by that surface wrapping around. Does that make sense? So I have the sides, I have the surface, and both of those can make edges on this little curly ribbon. I'm just going to take a close look at this part of this ribbon right here. Bounce back here. I'm going to draw these shapes here. I've got this top side. Comes up like that. I have the bottom side that's kind of coming around like this. And then I have these edges here. I'm going to redraw this right over here. I like that one better. Here is. It's interesting to note that with these lines, this view is as if you had X-ray vision, and you could see through the ribbon. And with these same lines, depending on which ones I erase, I can make the ribbon flipped towards you or away from you. Take a look at this. If I take these two lines here and here, I get something much like that. However, if I erase this line here and this line here, it just flipped the other direction. So these two lines, sometimes when you're thinking structurally like this, your brain can kind of get wrapped around like, oh wait, is that the close side or is that the far side? What's wrong with me? They seem to be kind of flickering back and forth. They're kind of doing some Escher thing in your brain, right? They are doing an Escher thing in your brain. They could be visualized either way. So this works this way. These same lines also can work. Oops, this way. So this or this, depending on which one I would put in front. So this is why kind of thinking structurally kind of sometimes makes our brains hurt, because you know the thing will start to kind of flick back and forth, like what's the close edge, what's the far side. The approach which I find that really helps me be able to draw curling leaves and petals and not get confused by this is, instead of starting structurally, in which case my brain is jumping back and forth between these things, I start by looking at the shapes, and I assemble a bunch of the shapes together, and then I come back and double check to make sure that it makes sense when I look at it from a structural point of view. So I'm going to take a look at drawing with looking at a leaf, and how these same ideas of structure and shape would kind of play themselves out in looking at a leaf. Here we are. So here's some photographs of leaves. If I'm thinking of this in terms of putting shapes next to shapes. I want to look at the underside of this leaf as one shape. And then I'm going to look at the top side of the leaf as another shape that's just adjacent to it. If I put this shape next to that shape, I have the lines that make up this leaf. Let's take a look at this one here. Right. See if on your piece of paper you can draw this one and construct this leaf. First, look at this underside as a shape, and then look at this top side as a shape. I'll get out of your way and mess with this one. This way of looking at leaves gets your head out of the place of thinking, how should a leaf look? And really getting yourself to see, how does that leaf from this angle actually look? You can also look at these leaves structural. Remember the surface and the side and the side. So if I take my leaves and I put, here's one side, I've drawn a yellow line along it, and the other side I've drawn a blue line. So I've got a side and a side. And notice that the side starts here, it has to end up there. So something that starts here, it has to end up there again. It goes all the way up there, I see it picking up. Notice that I cannot see that blue side all the way across. This yellow one I see, oh, there's that side. But this blue one has actually disappeared behind the surface of the leaf for a little bit of its length. So I have to project where I'm losing it and then pick up where I see it again and figure out what is happening behind the scenes. Just as the two sides are nice, constant, consistent lines, so is the center vein of this. So the center vein is going to start in one place, end in another. Even if it's arching over somewhere, what is going up here is going to have to come down there. Also notice that not all the edges of the leaf, if I have the side of the leaf and the side of the leaf, not all the edges of this leaf are accounted for. I still have this right here that's made by the surface of that leaf curling over, just like we had that surface of the ribbon before. So that the edges of this are either made by the sides or that surface. So how do I draw this? If I was trying to draw this leaf, I would look at this top part just as a flat shape. Your brain is a great tool for seeing things three-dimensionally. Because you have two eyes this far apart, you see things three-dimensionally. Because what's happening is this eye is seeing things from one angle, this eye is seeing them from another angle. Your brain is doing a beautiful calculation, looking at what is the difference between the images that I'm getting between these two eyes. The greater the difference, the closer the object is to you. So if you take your thumb, close one eye, and cover up my head with your thumb, and switch eyes, you'll see that your two eyes are really seeing a different image. Similarly, take your two fingers and line them up this way. So you're looking, close one eye, line your fingers up, and then switch eyes. All right. Notice that the closer it is to you, the greater a difference you'll see. If I bring them way out here, not as much of a jump. But in here, at the distance where most people are drawing a little wildflower, big difference between what one eye sees and the other. So if I want to, when I'm drawing on a piece of paper, no matter how good my shading, this paper is still just a two-dimensional surface. So what I'm doing is I'm trying to trick people by taking a three-dimensional thing and getting a representation of that on this two-dimensional surface that I'm going to try to make it look like it has depth. But it's confusing to try to get three dimensions where I'm seeing two images onto a surface where they're, where it's now actually just 2D, no matter how good my shading is. So when I'm looking at the flower, what I'll often do is, instead of confusing my brain by seeing two images and trying to draw one, what do?
Close one eye.
Close one eye. Great trick for flowers that are close to you. When I look at the flower, I close one eye, and then when I go back to draw on my piece of paper, I can open both my eyes so I'll know like when my pencil is going to hit my paper. And I go back and I look at the flower, I close that same eye. Draw with two, look with one. I don't have to do that on a distant landscape because the difference between those two images is so minuscule that I'm really not seeing a difference. But on things that are in this range, it makes a huge difference to close one eye when you look at it. So what I do is I close one eye and I'm going to look at the top of this leaf as a shape, as a flat two-dimensional shape, as if I were cutting this out of a piece of fabric because I wanted to make a quilt. And I'm going to look at the bottom of this as a flat shape. This doesn't look to me like a leaf. This doesn't look like a leaf. What I have to do is just believe what I'm seeing in front of me and just trust that I'm going to trust the shape, and if I sew those two pieces together, I get something that looks like a leaf. So you're going to see the shape, put it down as faithfully as you can, sew them together, and that will make your leaves. So we're going to try to see this right now. If you have a leaf model from the previous class, let's get those out right now. If you don't have a leaf model with you, I've got more of them. Who needs a leaf? So, friends at home, if you're watching some of the video, go to johnmuirlaws.com and you can download the leaf models. I've got a blog post here where you can download these, or if you're doing this as a class setting, you can download a big sheet with multiples of them for all your students. Or you can get one with just one leaf and one flower model for you to do. But for folks who are here in the room, I've got leaf models for you.
Thank you.
There you go. Did you want one of those?
Thank you.
You're welcome. Alright. So last time, in our previous class, we took this leaf model and we were rocking it this way and going, look at how the angles change and the width changes, and then we got really freaked out when we sent it at an angle over our shoulder and looked at it's no longer symmetrical, and finding out really cool things about it. This time, what we're going to be doing is I'm going to put a curve like that into my leaf. So like, just like it's a little piece of curling ribbon. Try to kind of keep it flat, going choop, so it's not twisting too much. Right. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to hold this in front of me at eye level, close one eye, and I want to hold it so that I can see both the top and the underside of it at the same time. Right. I want to see the top and the bottom. What is the shape that the top makes?
Triangle.
It's a triangle. See, it's an equilateral triangle if yours is curling fairly straight towards you. So I'm seeing, I'm going to draw it on the board here, a little triangle that is roughly flat top, roughly coming like that. Are we on the same page with that? So the top is just a shape. What is the shape of the underside? Sort of a wine glass with a V top. And depending on how you roll it, you may see something like this. Or you may see something like this, with kind of a heart shape. But in either case, what you've got is just a shape next to a shape. A shape next to a shape and a shape next to a shape. So what you want to do is trust the shape that you see. Get the idea in your head of how it should look out of there, right? And trust the shape that you see. Now, are we good with this view? We're going to take it a step further, because what we're going to do is we're going to look at it and close one eye, and I want you to now point the tip of it over your right shoulder. Point the tip of it over your right shoulder. Now look at the shape at the top. Is it still symmetrical? All right, take a look at the shape of the two top corners. How are they different?
Wider and narrower.
So it's a wide one and a narrow one.
The one is closer to the longer.
One is long and skinny. And the other one, I'm seeing people go like this, the other one is actually rounded. Right? It doesn't have a sharp corner. It's a rounded corner. And the other side, are you seeing that? Isn't that cool? So what I want to do, and also notice that there's a long side and a short side. The lengths of those two sides are not the same. Alright, so I want to not just draw the way I think it should look, I want to train myself to really look at this shape. What am I actually seeing from this angle? And that's what I want to put on the piece of paper. So I'm seeing something that is roughly rounded side, roughly like that. And that's the shape I write down, I put down on my paper. That is adjacent to another shape. Take a look at the shape of the underside. It also has a rounded side and a sharp corner. It's a rounded side. And it has a sharp corner. I put those together, and presto, I have a curling leaf that's, you're seeing the top and the bottom, it's twisting through space, it's off at a three-quarter angle. By just trusting the shape next to a shape, you have drawn a really complex, sophisticated shape here. Pat yourself on the back.
Yay!
Yay! Give it a try. Take this leaf, turn it at some other funky angle, and draw what you see. You're going to be taking this leaf model when you get home and putting it on the back of your toilet tank with a little sketchbook. And for the next week, I want you just to, as you're going to the bathroom in the morning, pick this up and make a little leaf sketch with it. And what you're going to be doing is training your brain to, why are we doing it then? Because you won't do it any other time. Right? Because every moment of your day is already full. Right? But you're going to be training your brain to take this geometric shape, to train your brain to flatten it. You're going to train your brain to trust the shape that you see and how to splice those together. And that's all you need to do.
It's hard to do when I'm in the bathroom in the morning.
That's true. There might be an extra challenge, yeah. Gotcha. I'll let you work out the logistics of it. How did that work?
Better than before.
Better than before?
Yeah.
I want to show you folks the most common mistake people make with this. And I looked at a lot of people doing this exercise, and there's one mistake that kept popping up again and again and again, and I couldn't figure out why. And then I realized it's because we're really smart. And our brain is doing this really sophisticated cubist thing with us. Your brain is noticing that this, from this angle, is a big curved top. So drawing this curved top as a flat line, your brain goes, I know that this is curved. So what it wants to do is to do this. Right? It's really easy to bow this part up because we know that the top from this angle is curved. But when I look at what I'm really seeing, I'm seeing that surface of the edge coming over there. So beware the bubble top leaf. Another thing that's we can notice with this is that this model will help you kind of explore another aspect of leaf geometry. Not all leaves are perfectly flat surface. Very often you'll find leaves that are slightly book-shaped, with the two edges one higher than the other. Raindrops fall and they run down and drip off. It turns out that you cannot make your leaf boat-shaped and curved at the same time. You can either curve this, or if there's, you know, part of just sort of being a flat piece of paper, it doesn't like to be curved and boat-shaped at the same time, unless you get into some really crazy origami folds here. But we're going to just explore the boat-shaped business for a moment. So flatten your leaf out and fold it into a little boat. Notice when you look at it from the end that you see the V. Right? You also get a hint of this V-ness of it by close one eye and look straight into it. And then tilt the top edge away from you. See if I don't know if this will come out on the screen, but for friends at home, you are doing that. Notice how the bottom, what happens to the bottom edge?
It's foreshortened.
Yeah, it shortens. It, so the center line, the mid vein, is no longer in the middle of the leaf that you see. There's more stuff on one side than the other. And that's true if you're looking at the top or the bottom. Because it's V-shaped, one of those surfaces is going to be more foreshortened than the other. So if I am V-shaped and I'm tilted towards you, this arm's not foreshortened, this one is. So this surface of the leaf is going to be shortened towards you, this one isn't. So what does that mean if I'm drawing a leaf here? If I start off with that same kind of leaf model that I had before, I'm going to have a couple of things going on. The first is that the mid vein doesn't go up the middle of it. It's going to be closer to one side. I'm going to see the top surface of the leaf, the V in it, it's going to come down to that. And then on the back side, so I'm going to have a wide side and a narrow side. I'm going to have a wide side and a narrow side. And I'm going to have also that V showing in the top surface of the leaf.
I'm sorry, what about it not being curved and V at the same time?
That's just hard to do with the white of the paper model.
Oh,
real leaves do it all
yeah,
the time.
Okay.
Real leaves are doing that and V. Our paper model doesn't want to do both at the same time. But you'll see this, take a look at this leaf here. See, here's the V in the top. And I have wide side, narrow side, wide side, narrow side. When I construct these leaves, by putting a shape next to a shape, there is a danger of something going askew. What, besides the big red circle with slash, what is wrong with this picture? What's wrong with this picture?
Center vein is not.
Oh yeah, look at that center vein. You can't get there from here. Right? I want this to match up with what's happening down here. Similarly, I want this edge to be able to match up with this point where I start to pick it up again. So there, the parts which are outside of my view still need to work structurally. So I want to think, how can I see through my leaf? Take your leaf, curl it again, right? So you can see both the top and the bottom, and some of that view pointed over your right shoulder. Some of that leaf is hidden from your field of view. Just put your finger along the opposite side and feel that edge that is going out of your line of sight. Can you visualize that through the leaf?
Mm-hmm.
You want to make sure that that is a curved, smooth line, just as the one that's on the closest side is. If it has to go, something's askew. Right? That's probably your drawing. So if I correct this, it's going to look like this. I want to be able to see. Oh, Lori, you rock. So Lori just walked outside, found a leaf that is curling, and V-shaped. We're going to take this, we're going to pass it around the room, and notice that you can see these same sorts of features going on the real leaf. That's great. We'll just pass this little bad boy around. So you, what I'll do is I will initially block in my leaf using a shape next to a shape. And then to make sure I'm not doing this, I'll just visualize to myself, does that make sense three-dimensionally? If I had x-ray vision and I saw through that, oh no, something is off. I will fix the shape of my leaf. I made it way too wide, pushing these two sides out this way. I need to bring that back because it's weird to think how asymmetric these two sides will be. Right? So it may force me to kind of make this walk too wide down this way. So I can correct that by getting my brain to visualize this leaf structurally. And this works if I'm drawing leaves or if I'm drawing petals. So for the iris here, I drew this as a shape next to a shape. And I sewed those together to make the petal. Are there any questions? Well, by the way, on questions, if you have a question, it's okay to ask it. If you have a question, probably a lot of other people do in the room also have that same question. They're just even more shy than you are. Right? So here's what I'm going to do now. I'm going to take this idea. Okay, let's say I can make a petal. But how do I stitch that together on a big, confusing iris? In last week's class, last month's class, we looked at, you know, how do you kind of block in this the symmetry of a simple flat circular flower or a little cone. If you're doing something like this, much more complicated, much more detailed. So how do you break down a complex shape and get it onto the piece of paper? What do you do for kind of your initial blue pencil lines if you're looking at something gasp like this? You could just draw the poppy, right? But hypothetically, should you choose to do this, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to put down blue pencil lines. First thought with these blue pencil lines is there is no pattern that you're supposed to be making. There's no one right way to doing it. But if I can put down a few basic guidelines for me that will do two things, I'll be in great shape. So the two things are, I want to show the basic proportions of the major parts. How big are they relative to each other? And the second is, can I put down some lines that will help me capture some of the angles and the positions of similar parts across this thing? So for instance, I have three big sepals here that are all drooping down. Right? They're the tips of those. If you look at it straight from the side, they're all at the same level. I then have a layer in here of pistils, and I have a layer in here of petals coming up. How can I kind of summarize the geometry of those things? So initially what I would do is just put in the center line of this flower and just put in a big oval saying I've got a bottom part that's about this wide, and I have a top part that's about this tall. So those two, with those lines, I have summarized a bunch of the critical information about this. Here I'm thinking proportions. I've got its posture, I've got its proportions. To help me get the tips of these sepals or the petals in the right places, I want to have some sort of a line that will help me get the alignment of those. When we're drawing a single flower, we looked at how drawing a circle or an ellipse allowed us to foreshorten parts of a flower that we're seeing from an angle. The same thing is going to be happening here. I want to take the tips of each one of those sepals and imagine those connected by a big hula hoop. That's my circle, going around the tips of the same structures. And I can do the same thing with a different circle going around the tips of the pistils, or the tips of the petals on the tops of this thing. So those are my circles. Remember last month's class, we really kind of got into how do ellipses change from different angles. You might want to go back and kind of review that in the video. But when I'm drawing this, these are a couple of sort of fundamental things that might be nice to have in my kind of blue pencil scratch drawing. There's no one right way to draw it. Anything that begins to get some of these ideas down on the paper for you, however you draw it, is great. So I used to think like there's going to be some formula for getting the shape the right way. There's a bunch of different ways of doing it. But I want to have those two ideas in mind. How can I kind of maintain the alignment of similar parts? How can I get the basic proportions of this thing? In this case, what I decided to do is to draw a big oval, got the center line, a big oval over the petals, a big oval around the sepals there, and kind of block that in, because the whole thing did feel very triangular to me. Then I put in those circles on top of them. So I don't have to just do one, I can do it all. Now, on top of this framework, I'm going to start with some big structures, put them onto my drawing, and those will be my anchor points for fitting other things around them. So I'm going to take this great big sepal that's right in front, and I'm going to notice where that goes on this drawing here. So I'm going to take this big feature, plop it in here. It's roughly going to go in this area. What can I do to get these sepals in the right place? I could just kind of eyeball it, kind of go like, okay, I've got one that's sort of going to come out here, and one that's going to come out here.
Could you imagine where they're meeting the stem?
On that point. Where the dom is?
So I can think of where are they kind of going in and meeting the stem. So imagining what's happening three-dimensionally there. It's going to be very helpful too.
Then marking points on that oval where the tips are.
Right? Yep, so I can put where are these on this oval going to come in. And another thing, a tool in my quiver, is to look at the shapes of the negative spaces between the sepals. So I don't want to just draw this big purple thing, then this purple thing, then this purple thing. The shapes of those black spaces between them are as important as the shape of the purple thing. So if I draw in the shape of that black space here, I'm refining the edge of this, and I'm getting the bottom edge of this one and the exact distance between them. So what I do is I draw the positive shape, then I draw the negative shape that's next to that, the black space, and then I attach onto that the positive shape of the sepal on the other side. So I'm going to go draw the purple, draw the black, draw the purple. I don't have to actually draw in the black zone. So the red lines here are just, this is what you're envisioning. Right? I'm seeing, oh, there's a skinny one over here. There's a big one right over here. Right? So I want to visualize this as I draw that edge. Negative spaces are our friends. And it helps, rather than doing one at the side and then kind of working your way across like that, it helps to do one right in the middle, because then there's, it's kind of like playing telephone. If I start here and make a little mistake, that's going to get pushed all the way through. So if I start with a major feature in the middle, I'm having to kind of do fewer steps out to the side. There's a smaller chance that I'm going to take a mistake and just sort of multiply that out. So that's why I like to put a thing in the center line first and then work my way towards the sides as I'm looking at these positive and negative shapes. And I can do the same thing up top. So I first put in the center, then that, then that, then that, then that. So positive, negative, positive. The shapes of those black areas between are going to be as important as getting the shapes of those purple petals on the top.
What pencil are you using?
This is with a Prismacolor Verathin pencil. And by the way, I'm not actually drawing in the red part. I'm using the Prismacolor Verathin pencil here. If I'm doing this at home or in the field, what I'm actually doing is by using my non-photo blue pencil.
Yes.
But it turns out when I do the non-photo blue pencil, it's so light that when I scan it, it doesn't show up. So to have this show up, this is sort of what I would be doing with my that very pale non-photo blue pencil.
But still with the hash marks kind of too.
But I'm not, I don't put in the hash marks. I'm just, the red zones are just what I'm visualizing. I visualize this to get this in the right place. So I don't have to fill anything in these spaces here. But I want to look at that as a shape. As I'm drawing this edge here, I'm thinking about this shape. And then I just fold the top of that panel on top of it. Once I've got that, I put down my non-photo blue pencil and I pick up my regular graphite pencil or whatever color pencil I want to draw with. And now I'm going to start drawing. Instead of from the center out, I'm going to draw from front to back. The idea of drawing front to back is that there are objects overlapping. If I draw this one first, I know exactly where to stop drawing this one. And I've already got them sort of framed in roughly where they are. So the features that are in front here, I've got a big sepal down here, pistil, a couple of petals outside. And again, this is just a shape next to a shape next to a shape next to a shape. So here I'm using that multiple shape technique to fill out this shape coming up there. Do what's in front first, then fit the other stuff in behind them. These negative shapes on the side also help me look at these forms and these angles more dynamically. If I really, I want to pay attention to what is that angle there? Ooh, that's neat. Can I get that little narrow wedge in there? Negative shapes are probably the best drawing trick that is used the least by people who are just starting to draw. So the thing that people are really experienced artists that are doing that other folks who are just starting art, a lot of those more experienced artists are really leveraging negative shapes a lot. And their brain is flickering back between looking at this and looking at this, and seeing them as an equal weight. The final step is to drop in detail. If I draw a detail as I'm going along, I end up putting the same amount of detail over everything. But if I put detail in at the end, I can be really decisive and deliberate about where I put it. The drawing will flatten out if detail is everywhere. But if you put more detail on the parts that are closer to you, those parts will pop forward. So if you intentionally put the detail at the end, it lets you be kind of planned about how much detail you're going to put where. Notice that these little lines, those nectar guides on that sepal in front, do a lot to round this object. Here it looks flat. But I'm noticing, oh, I've got lines that come down straight here. On the side out here, they are kind of coming out kind of increasingly round this way. And so I have a little curve and it comes down. I have more of a curve and it comes down. I put in that little bit of a curve, and that starts to feel rounded coming over the top. Anytime you have lines on a petal or something, they can really help you show changes in angle of shapes and things. They're really very, very helpful. So this is drawn with a colored pencil. Here's the same thing with graphite. Here's the same thing with an ink pen. These are markers or watercolor. Doesn't matter what sort of medium you're using, the same ideas will have can come out to play. Just to belabor the idea of drawing front to back one more time, because it's for me it's a really helpful strategy. If I'm drawing this character, I've got all these complex things that are overlapping. I want to do this and this before this stuff that's back here. So I would start with this close petal and then wrap this behind it, looking at the negative space here. So I might start with this and then draw in the rest of that sepal coming down here, paying attention to that negative space. Once I have that, here is this pistil structure coming up on top. Each little kind of change in angles of it is just a different shape, and I'm splicing those together. So I'm looking at a shape next to a shape next to a shape next to a shape. Yes?
When you go to put them together, to sew them together, how do you line them up in exactly the right place?
It depends on how kind of confused I'm feeling by it.
I was feeling very confused.
Right. If I'm feeling very confused, I might lightly have something kind of sketched in that is sort of showing me my overall target shape with my non-photo blue pencil. You notice on that first one, that first iris demo, I had lots of those sort of positions of those features kind of blocked in. And then I can kind of come along and say, all right, here is this shape, and it is next to this shape here, right, on top of that. If I'm feeling not as confused and disoriented by the elements that are on there, then I can just have a few kind of rough placeholders and freelance it. But if I'm feeling like, whoa, I'm going to need some more support here, I just get out my blue pencil again and say, I'm going to need some guidelines specifically for that. So here's adding stuff further back and dropping more stuff behind that and more stuff behind that. And this here looks pretty flat, but if I strengthen the lines of the parts that are coming towards me and give them a little bit more detail, those parts will pop forward in the drawing. So the thickness of the line, the strength of the line, and the amount of detail, those are great features for getting more depth in the drawing. If I'm adding color or value, there's a few other things in my quiver, so not just detail. Compare this with this. And notice that I'm lying here. I actually could see more detail on this sepal that was back here. But I chose not to put it in because that would flatten the drawing out. There's another way that I'm lying here, which is that this is a lot paler than this. If I look at distant mountains, those will look really pale because there's scattered light between me and those mountains. Here I'm using that same landscape drawing trick to suggest depth in this. By having this be lighter and less detailed, it feels like it's way behind this one here. But really, when I'm looking at this much space on a real flower, there's not enough scattered light there to have those details drop out and for that thing to turn pale. So I'm using a trick of landscape drawing to suggest depth, even though on the real thing I can't see that. And I'm just, what I'm doing here, I'm making a judgment call. I'm not being actually as true to the detail that I see in that object, but I am making it easier to read and understand the shape. And that's a balance. I just had a photograph of it. The photograph could actually look really flat. It'd be hard to tell, is that one in front or is that one behind? So it's a judgment call. And you get to make that call. And that is fun with irises. So take a big deep breath. Relax your shoulders. Shake them out. That was a lot of really intense stuff in a short period of time. There are some really powerful ideas there of how to represent what you see with these complex shapes. Right? Let's see if we can just make some a bullet point list of the major concepts that you just saw. What were some of the major drawing ideas that you just encountered?
Finding shapes.
So shape, stitching a shape next to a shape next to a shape. It's a different way of thinking. Excellent. What else?
The negative space.
That's huge. Negative spaces. Right? The more we leverage that, it's going to place all sorts of parts, it makes all sorts of aspects of drawing that were difficult a lot easier.
Center out.
When I'm placing those negative space and things, so I'm not taking a little mistake and multiplying that across the thing. So when I'm doing the basic framework, I'm going center out, looking at negative space. And then when I'm drawing the details in the individual parts, how am I doing it?
Front to back.
Front to back. So I've got, sometimes I'm drawing this way, and then switching and drawing this way. I'm adding the detail at the end deliberately, so I can choose where to put my detail to give me more of a sense of depth. Whew. You ready for Lupine?
Yeah.
All right. So the challenge of Lupine is different. The challenge of Lupine is that there's a whole bunch of little parts that are repeating again and again and again and again and again. And you get sick of drawing flowers. All right? And in part way through, you're like, I think this Lupine should have fewer whorls. and sometimes you're just so lost in the weeds of drawing little flowers that you kind of are, you're not really tracking the big picture of what's going on, and you're like, you run out of paper before you get to the top of your Lupine, or it's just cramped up against the top of your sketchbook. So we're going to take a look at some ideas that are get around some of these problems. Rather, if you've anybody been drawing a Lupine, you're like, which flower was I on? You get lost somewhere in Lupine land there. So to kind of bring it back in, what I do is I first start by getting really familiar with what is the structure or shape that I'm going to be repeating a million times. And I'm going to draw that really big. I'm going to do an enlargement of it so I can really understand what is happening there. Because I'm going to then be simplifying this shape a bunch of times and at different levels of detail. So I want to first really know what's going on there. So here's a front view and a side view of a Lupine. A flower going, okay, it's got this big banner up here with it kind of wider at the side and then kind of curls into itself. There's like a clamshell right here, this little keel that sticks up in the front of this with, I can see this little part underneath the side between this sort of this clamshell of petals that comes down here. You guys can see a little bit more of my flowers sort of dipping out the bottom of that, kind of looks like a teardrop there. Huh, interesting. Oh, this is how my little, the stem, the petiole is going to attach onto it. So I'll notice those sorts of things. And I'm going to be doing miniature versions of this again and again and again and again and again and again. So I want to kind of get tracking with it from the start. My first step is to make sure I don't run out of paper. I'm going to lightly, loosely, with my non-photo blue pencil, get the center line of it and how wide it is. Right, what are its basic proportions? Some species of Lupine, or for our friends in Texas, the blue bonnets, some species of Lupines their flowers are in whorls, little rings of flowers coming out at different levels. Some species actually have them more randomly distributed and ends up being a useful characteristic in taxonomic keys, but we're going to go with one that has these in levels. So if mine has layers of flowers, I'm going to block in the locations of those layers of flowers. Here I'm drawing little sections of a cone. to help me think of this three-dimensionally. Now, on top of this, I'm going to start to systematically, starting from the bottom, working my way up, I am going to start in the middle, which is going to be the one that's the closest to me, and work my way out to the sides. So as I go out to the sides, these objects can be tucking in behind that one that's there in the middle. So I'm starting with what's closest to you, and when I'm drawing that, I'm going to use more pressure. I'm going to add in more detail. All right? It's going to be a more little flower. And then out to the sides of it, fortunately I've studied the shape of those things out to the sides. Here are little ones out to the sides. Notice I'm not using line pressure that says great. And then behind those, one more that's even lighter. So as I'm dropping back here in the picture, I'm changing how I draw. So in the center, bold, heavy lines, going out, lightening up a little bit, come over here, and dropping behind them. Look at how much detail is in this flower right here. As you get towards the back, you can just put in the shape of a flower, and that's going to stand in for drawing a whole flower. So they get easier to draw as you go towards the back. So center, sides, and wrapping around behind us. Notice that change in pencil pressure. Center, sides, wrapping around three-dimensionally. The top part here was a big spike of flowers, and I stopped seeing those individual whorls. So what I did is just drew all the ones that were right in the center line more distinctively. And then tucked in around those edges in lighter pencil, this a suggestion of the shapes of the other flowers. So deliberately going front to back, it allows me to get this, all of a sudden down the center line of the flower, these things are more detailed, they're darker, and the line drawing itself has more depth. Now I'm going to take this and turn it into a watercolor drawing. Here's a huge time-saving trick for these. If you paint this flower, and then this flower, and then this flower, and then this one, then this one, then this one, then this one, you're going to stop somewhere about there because you're going to get sick of painting. It's going to take forever. Instead, what I'm going to do is I'm going to mix up one color, and I'm going to apply that across the entire flower. So what I'm going to do here is mix up my purple and blue, and I put those across my flowers. I started with the ones right in the center line. And then as my little water brush started to run out of paint, it became more diluted. And I did the ones out on the sides. And then when it was even more diluted than that, I put a little hint of color on the ones behind it. And it gives me this sense of depth. That's just my brush running out of paint. But because I'm going front to back with applying it, I get this depth effect. Again, this is lying to show visual information. When I'm really looking at that thing, I'm not seeing that much of, there's not like a fog bank between me and those back petals. But it gives me a suggestion of depth. Until we really point it out, people just kind of go like, oh yeah. Then I clean my brush and put on green. Started up in here and down here. And as that brush ran out of paint, I kind of put a little bit in there. And it starts to make these wonderful values and things when it goes over some of that light purple. So this is just couple of quick brush applications so far. It hasn't taken long to do that. My next step is to mix up some maroon, right? And I applied that to the stem, and also the little places where each flower attached on have a little sort of darker purple bit in there. And my flowers have their colors blocked in. I just let it dry a little bit in the sun between each little coat. Those colors don't blend into each other, it doesn't make a mess. And it goes really fast that way. Once that's dry, then I put on my details. And again, I'm doing all my details at once so I can be strategic, more details on the parts that are closer to me. Notice on some of these back ones, no details back. A lot of detail, less detail, no detail. Notice that this guy is basically the same as that guy. Finally, I came along with my little gel pen, little white pen for drawing in some details. A white gel pen added in some little lines along some of the edges of these petals, popped a few little details by doing that, and I was done. So the whole drawing, start to finish, took about 45 minutes. Testing my colors off on the side of a piece of paper so I'm not mixing up some paint and then applying it here and going, ooh, I didn't think it would be that color, is a good idea. So test paper. Also, sometimes your brush is too watery and you don't know it until it touches down on the paper and then there's like a little puddle there. And then you're like, oh no, and you kind of blot it up and you're like, oh, I didn't like that, and I'll come back there. And later you're trying to come in and put some detail in there and it's still wet, you didn't know it, and kind of get in there and it was... So, I love the sort of test strips of how much water, how fine a line can I make. For your pleasure, the Lupine. Yes?
For the petal detail, are you using a pen or a watercolor to
it? This was the water brush again. Another thing you could do is switch to colored pencils at that point. Either way. You could do this. It might be easier to do those little lines with some colored pencils if you happen to have one with you. Or...
And you're still using that concept of the lines are curving away from you or curving towards you, right?
Yeah, so on a lot of these ones here, I can really kind of wrap those little lines around. I'll put this up on my blog post as a step-by-step tutorial along with the iris and some of these other ones. And so you can kind of look at those individual images a little closer, and you can sort of see how those lines wrap around, giving a sense of roundness to that little structure. So after all this intense stuff, we get an easy one. All right, this is an easy solution. If you've ever been out there drawing like a yarrow flower, which is a little clump of small white flowers, you get in there and you draw the flowers, all the little petals, and there's another little flower next to that, and by the time you get done, you have this big wad of dark gray graphite where the white flower should be. Right? It takes a long time, and it looks like a big gray snowball. All right? And so if you want to get that sense of depth in a clump of little flowers without drawing all those, that there's a wonderful shortcut, which is just to draw a jaggedy, irregular line around the edge of your clump that suggests the texture of those flowers in profile. And then draw like one flower, or maybe two flowers, right on the center line, or somewhere close to the middle of the flower, and then a little hint of kind of flowery detail, but not quite full flowers, a little bit less detail out there. All right? So this clump of flowers has one flower drawn on it, and it's right there. But you see that, and you go, oh, this is a whole cluster of flowers. So again, I would go, I've got a little stalk, stemmy thing that's kind of coming up like this. I want to make this kind of consistently inconsistent little cluster of flowers. I would draw, oh look, I've got a flower there, and then some little hint of, here, and a stop. That's what I'm doing in here. That's what I'm doing in across this. You get a close-up of a flower, one, two flowers there on this. And then just some squiggles that suggest floweriness. And bam, you're out of there. Our last category are tube-shaped and bilaterally symmetrical flowers. So, not all flowers are on a little flat disc. Right? We looked at some that were cone-shaped, but sometimes there's like this long spur. Whoa. There's a long spur that is coming off the back of the flowers, or it's on top of a long tube stalk. We're first going to look at some some radially symmetrical flowers that are tube-shaped, and then look at how might we approach a bilaterally symmetrical flower. So with a little bit of definitions, radially symmetrical versus bilaterally symmetrical. For radially symmetrical, think of a pizza. Any way you cut it, you're going to slice it in half, right? Bilaterally symmetrical is the calzone, right? There's only one really way that you can cut that in half and the two people won't get in a fight. Right? There's one slice through that. That's bilaterally symmetrical. I'm bilaterally symmetrical. My two halves are roughly the same to each other. You could slice me through this axis and get two sides that look the same. But this way, they look really different. Right? So, let's start with thinking about tube-shaped flowers. All I'm doing to make a tube-shaped flower is before we looked at here, you know, here's how to draw a flat flower in the previous class. For a tube-shaped flower, all I'm doing is putting a little circle in the center of it where my tube is going to attach to, and my tube comes down out of that. Or it doesn't have to be a flat thing. This could be a cone. Like that. That is fitting into a long tube. If I can see the hole where the tube kind of goes down, I want to be really careful to make sure that the dimensions of this hole line up with the sides of the cone that I'm extending in the back. That's a big deal. So if I have a little hole here and a big thing back here, or a big hole in front and a little tube coming in, or the tube doesn't, if I have the tube coming in over here, that's not going to work. Right? So I really want to make sure those elements are aligned. I block it in with my non-photo glue pencil and then can draw on top of it. Notice that if I can see the hole, I only am drawing in the side of the hole that's on the side that is closest to me. The far side, I have this front edge, the petal is, so on this edge here, this petal is wrapped up here, and where that petal curls, that's what makes that part right there. On the far side, in contrast, right, it is, this petal is flopping out like that. There is no other side of the line there. So it's really tempting to draw this in like that. Just avoid that temptation. You draw in the side that's closest to you, and you are good to go. If there are nectar guides or lines on these petals, they will change their angle when they get to the event horizon here. Right? When they come to the edge and go, whoa! Right? So there might be a line coming down this, and then when it gets here, they are going to trace down this tube. So you want to think of what are they going to do? Here they're going to come up and it disappear. This one is going to come. Shh. Very often, these will then have stamen and pistils sticking out of them, partially obscuring what's going on right here. I can remove that from this drawing just so we can kind of be clear on the flower structure. So that's tube-shaped flowers. We also want to think about bilaterally symmetrical flowers. One way to handle bilaterally symmetrical flowers, also helps with the tube-shaped flowers, is to get several drawings of them all going at the same time. So if I can show it from the front, from the back, from the side, that lets your viewer know and understand what they're looking at much more clearly. So if they're in a little cluster, you can take advantage of that, getting several views at once. If you are drawing a single flower, kind of a three-quarter view angle often is very useful for suggesting that. Here I have a circle of my flower, I have where the tube connects to it, but I also want to keep track of the center line of the flower. My petals on either side will be roughly symmetrical on either side of that, so not top to bottom, but I'll have a similar sort of pattern happening on either side of that center line of the flower. There's connecting it to a little tube. These lines are going to help me keep the parts of my flower on either side of that center line relatively aligned with each other. And notice that on the side closest to me again, I can see the curve. On the far side, I don't. Here's another view, my center line, and these lines are going to help me keep the petals on either side aligned. And when people are drawing human faces, they will often take a line and just draw it down in the middle of the head, right? And that kind of is a really useful thing as that head turns to sort of visualize how that head is moving around, right? And then they'll draw a line through the eyes so that they don't get one eye high and one eye low. So think of this, you know, these are often called like, you know, monkey face or one of these sorts of names, they'll have those sorts of names. And because they do look like a little face. So use, just like artists are putting those crosshairs in to help you orient that face looking around. Here's the human face. Whoa, hey, come back. Human face kind of looking up this way. Right. It's also useful on these bilaterally symmetrical flowers. Are there any clumpy flower or bilaterally symmetrical flower questions before we have one last treat? Yes?
How do you put the flowers on the plant?
So the question is, how do you put the flowers on the plant? What I'm initially doing with my non-photo blue pencil is I'm often sort of blocking in how do these kind of, what are the angles that these come out? These angles where plants, where stems will come into the plant are going to be really different species to species to species. I was actually out looking at some willows and noticed that this two different species of willows had different branching angles. And if there's a branch that is coming out like this, I'm not going to have a plant that's then looking like this, because this same branch out of this angle, if it rotates towards me, I'm going to see that at a steeper angle. So the best way to do it is to look, to sit down in front of the plant, the plant is in front of you, and draw in the air, closing one eye, looking at what are those real angles that are coming in. And I'll block that in, I map it in with my non-photo blue pencil. You'll notice that where a, if this is my plant coming in, very often as this little stem comes in, sometimes there's a little, you'll see a little bud right up in that spot right there. Kind of a fun thing to look for. Sometimes you'll see a little bract, a little sticking off underneath where one of these things attach. So those are good things to look for. Sometimes there will be a sheath that will kind of partly wrap around here. So that will be different on different species, but all good things to sort of pay attention to. Don't assume that there's going to be one standard way of things coming in. And the angle is going to be particular to whatever it is that you're looking at. Did that address the question?
Well, yes and no. I guess my main concern was about all the clutter that's behind it. You know, it's nice if you've got a flower that's sticking out away from the rest of the bush, and you can see just that one flower with the blue sky behind it, but often that's not the case.
Yeah, so sometimes I would suggest drawing whatever. Like here, it's like, oh, look, everybody's not overlapped. Very often when I'm making a scientific illustration, I will kind of go around the flower to try to find an angle that kind of shows the structure clearly. You know, this is uncluttered, but actually the more that things actually do overlap, the more depth you get in the picture, because I can use overlap as another way of showing depth. So it's going to depend on what you want to show and do. Lastly, I want to send out a heartfelt apology to watercolor pencils. I have disparaged watercolor pencils in the past, and I recently had a revelation about, actually had a great time doing some drawing with watercolor pencils. And what I think it may be is what kind of watercolor pencils that you're using. Somebody suggested that I try watercolor pencils that are made by this company Faber-Castell. They're, what are they, Albrecht Dürer watercolor pencils. In the past, I've been frustrated because I would mix colors up and they would look great on the paper, and then I would hit them with a little bit of water and they would radically change their color. Like it had gone from a nice foresty green to chartreuse, right? And they would change their value. It went from being dark, all of a sudden it's really, really light. And that bugged me a lot. So I just said, ah, these are, I don't like them at all. The Albrecht Dürer ones, they didn't seem to be doing that with me. And I had a ton of fun doing it. And also, what I never liked about them in the past was that I would put in all my detail and then I'd try to put it in the water, and then I would just sort of blur all my detail. And what it was, is I was just using the pencils wrong. My order of operations when I'm adding the water. And so what, here's a little kind of a walkthrough of kind of my sort of happy moment with watercolor pencils. So what you don't see is all the non-photo blue pencil in the background. There's actually a lot of light non-photo blue pencil that allowed me to block this in. And then what I did is off on a separate piece of paper, I tested overlapping a bunch of colors and blurring them together, how they looked, and I went, wow, these ones are actually, they're not doing this sort of crazy color shift, and sort of figured out how I could mix, made this little sort of side palette, that I mix this with this, I get this color, this with this, and then I get this color, and then I just colored in on my little plant frame, right? Mixing several different pencils on top of that. And then this is the point near the start of the drawing where I added the water. So I laid in sort of a base coat of colors and then blended that and let it dry. What that did is it kind of covered up all those little kind of colored pencil holes. Yeah?
Could you go back one? Because the bottom edge of the front petal where it's curling, that's really shows when you just put more on that. And then when you wetted it, it really...
Yeah. Wow. Isn't that fun?
Yeah.
Oh. 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 right? So then I let this dry, and then, but it's like, oh, I kind of liked that texture that I was getting before, and now it's all gone. Oh dear. No, it's just dry now, and you just draw on top of it with more colored pencil. And you can bring all that detail, start to bring that detail back in. The detail is the last thing that goes in there. So I can then punch in my detail, and it's on top of something that connected all these little spaces. And I thought, you know, I like these little guys. So that might be something to experiment with more, and see if you like it. Just, I don't know why it didn't occur. Maybe everybody's been doing this. It kind of late adopter, because I just thought, oh, no, I don't like it. But the idea of applying the water, not at the end when you've put all the detail in, but before you do that. So then my detail I'm not hitting with water, and it just stays perfect. Seems to work pretty well.
So the brand you're recommending is?
Is Faber-Castell Albrecht Dürer watercolor pencils.
Can you go back one, two, three? And then?
No.
Forward.
You can also have fun kind of putting in surprising little colors. This was those, this sort of red brown that was putting in these little dark accents with, and that rather than just kind of getting a black pencil, there's no black pencil in there. It was fun. I had fun. So just a few take-home points, and we actually looked at a few other things. What's not on the list?
Detail and darker lines
are
close to
you. Yeah.
From center out.
Oh, from center out, when I'm placing those negative spaces, kind of working the center out, as opposed to front to back when I'm kind of drawing in my details. So these could be applied to anything you're drawing. These are not specific ideas just for messing with messing with an iris. Right? You'll see these have broad applicability to whatever it is that you want to draw. Your homework is to take these ideas and to mess with it. Because it turns out if you just go home and think, well, that was neat, maybe next month I'll draw something with it, your brain's just going to select all delete. Right? Instead, what you want to do is do 4 botanical studies. Just mess around with it. Think of them as studies, not like an art project. You're going to be experimenting. You're going to let yourself take risks. Let it look not like some perfect picture. Let it be something where you're sort of experimenting with these techniques and see what happens. Right? If you cut your teeth on that, then the next time you're out in the field, these ideas will be part of your quiver that you can apply to whatever it is that you're drawing in front of you. But just think of them as studies. If you drill it a little bit, they will be easily accessible to you the next time that you need it. Right. Take your little leaf model and put it someplace that you're going to have access to it. Just regularly get out. If you're kind of commuting on a bus somewhere, bring it with you and kind of close one eye and like freak out the person who's sitting next to you. I like the idea of placing them on the toilet tank behind you. And what it does is just gives you time to look at it again and again and again and again. Right? And what you're going to be doing is training yourself to see the shapes, training yourself to see the edges through it, as if you're trying to train yourself to have x-ray vision. So I want to look through it and say, it's great activity just to hold the leaf and feel where that other edge is. Kind of like, oh yeah, and then actually see that as a line through with the part that's obscuring your vision. You can do it and have fun. Right? Goof around with it. Then, when you come out to join us for our next field trip, you'll be ready for some wildflowers. And they should be there. We're going to be going to Oakland's Noland Park. How many people have been there? Nobody in the room. Okay. So we're going to go to a new spot that's not on the last Sunday of the month. Okay. But the Details of the trip and the directions are on johnmuirlaws.com. Bring a potluck treat to share. You can actually leave it in your car with your spoon and bowl, because we'll be back pulling those things out of the car around lunchtime. And we'll have a great feast up there on the mountain. Bring all your sketching supplies. We'll just have a great time and get a chance to learn about this wonderful little open space. And it'll be a real hoot. The next 2 months, we're going to have some special guests. Our next month's workshop is going to be taught by Kristen Muser, and she's going to be bringing in samples of paint, paper, and all you have to do is bring your own brush and a little bit of water. And we're going to be, she's going to help show us hands-on experimenting with the way that colors mix and don't mix. And it's a great way to really understand color mixing, to match a color precisely. That should be a lot of fun. The month after that, Lori Wiggum is going to be giving us another workshop on a really exciting topic. Do you want to tell people about what we're doing?
Sure.
Kind of come up this way so friends at home can see. So you guys will want to tune in for this. We'll also try to get it filmed.
And I apologize for skipping out during the lecture. I've heard this lecture of Jack's 4 times in the last 2 days, and I knew if I stayed here, I'd fall asleep and embarrass myself. So,
so you got some sketching on.
It's wonderful. I got some sketching on. So I'm going to be moving this into the art realm, which can seem terrifying if you didn't go to art school, but actually is pretty easy, because what it's really about is showing what you love and what excites you about being out there in nature, which is the reason we're all doing this, really. I'll be flipping through a bunch of slides to give examples of the principles I'm talking about, and then a lot of it's going to be hands-on, working through a bunch of exercises very quickly to just internalize the point. So I hope you can come.
It'll be really, really fun. July is going to be great. And last announcement is that the date is still in flux, but we're narrowing in on getting the amazing nature journaler Claire Walker Leslie to come out and do a workshop just for us. And that's going to be sometime in October. She's one of my greatest nature journaling inspirations, an incredible person, a really dynamic teacher, and a really inspirational journaler. She's written for me when I was a wee little nature journaler just getting started. I found this book called Nature Journaling, A Tool for Learning, and it was like my book. Being dyslexic, I can barely read, but I would just like work through every word and just soaked that book up. It made a huge difference for me. And she's since has all sorts of great titles. She's going to be coming out, we believe, and doing a 2-day workshop for us, followed by an opportunity to join us on the field on a field trip for everybody to enjoy. So we're really excited about that. When it gets nailed down and registration opens for it, I encourage everybody to beg, steal, or borrow, do everything you can do to get, it's going to be a Friday, Saturday workshop. Get that Friday off. It'll be so worth it. And so that's a really exciting thing to look forward to. That will be coming towards the end of this year. So it will be a great year for the Nature Journal Club. We're really going to hand on behind it with that. So I really want to thank to Lori and Kristen for being able to, for the next 2 months, to continue our monthly workshops. Also, there are going to be field trips every month. Even though I'm not going to be around, the field trips will continue. They're all up on johnmuirlaws.com right now, so you can find them there. And we'll see you in the field. Thank you.